rock of ages, cleft for me. Let me hide myself in thee, rock of ages, cleft for me. Let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood
to our final Holy Week service of worship on this Good Friday. We welcome you however you are tuning in, whether by radio or Facebook or YouTube, and we are grateful to all the participants this week, and especially to 94.1 who's made this possible so that you could hear it via radio or online. Today, I am really privileged to introduce you to several people from First Methodist who are going to be leading us in worship. All week long, you've enjoyed meditative music from Cherie Gibbs. And in a moment, before our lead pastor, Byron Vance, preaches, part of our praise team will be providing the special music, Jack Braxton and Megan Story. So, as we enter into worship, I invite you to be in a spirit of prayer as we reflect on this music, the very heart of God. Would you pray with me? Oh God, we enter into this holy place through the new and living way that Jesus has opened for us. We come as your people, holy people, created in your image and born of the grace of Jesus, delivered through his blood. Today we stand oh so near the cross, oh God, disturbed, distraught, discouraged. Yet we still gather here, those whom Jesus loves, on this solemn day. We pray that you would let us stand as witnesses to your great love for all the world, revealed in the outstretched arms of our Savior. In the darkness of this hour, Lord, we pray that you might be our light. By the breath of your Spirit, God, we ask you to whisper the words of life through your servant, Byron, that all might know that nothing, not even death, can destroy the love and the life that we find in you. We pray it all in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen and amen.
Held in your heart, my sinful condition kept us apart in the Garden of Gethsemane, where Percy met your majesty. Call of redemption, Father to Son. With tears of deep sorrow, your will be done. In the Garden of Gethsemane, where mercy met your majesty.
Praise the Son.
the name of Jesus, there is no higher love than this, no higher love than this. Oh, the love of Jesus, there is no greater name than this, no greater name than this. Oh, the name.
Get rid of it, so I have to share it with you. Mark's Gospel, chapter 15, verse 21. Anybody know it from memory? It's okay if you don't. It's a pretty familiar story. If you're familiar with the Gospel, with the story of Jesus, you've got four different Gospel accounts, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And they each contain elements of Jesus' story. But not all of them contain every piece altogether. But all four of them tell the story of Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. All four of them. But they tell in different ways. So it kind of lifts up different details, and you can see kind of the different emphasis, sometimes the audience, or what it is that the Holy Spirit's doing through the author as well. For some reason, I've read Mark. I love Mark's Gospel. And I love the Gospel account of his crucifixion in Mark. This verse has stuck in my head for weeks. It's simple, so let me read it to you. Simon, a man from Cyrene, Alexander and Rufus's father, was coming in from the countryside. They forced him to carry his cross. Now, this is God's word for us today, and you're thinking, there is so much more to the story than that. And you're right. But to get there, and to the significance of Simon, I really have to kind of tell you more of the story. Now, some of y'all may be listening and watching and thinking, I've heard the story of Jesus' crucifixion my whole lifetime. I've heard it hundreds, if not thousands of times. Every Sunday in church, I might hear of the crucifixion. Or every year, especially, definitely, I'll be hearing of the crucifixion. There's not a Sunday that I haven't been reminded of the crucifixion of Jesus. And there are many who are out there who are also listening, who may, maybe for the first time, are hearing the story of Jesus' crucifixion, his death and burial. I'm tempted to read the whole thing to you, but I'm not going to. Instead, I want to tell you the story from Mark's perspective. He was arrested. Y'all remember this. And he was arrested and at daybreak and he was taken out. And it names some people. Maybe this is why I keep hearing Simon's name in my head, because there were people that were named in the scene, including chief priests, legal scholars, experts, the elders, the whole Sanhedrin. They gathered early in the morning and they sought to arrest Jesus. They turned him over to Pilate. And when they turned him over to Pilate, the goal was to quiet him, to shut him down. And Pilate didn't want to have much to do with it. "It's not really my business," he would say. He tried to distance himself a couple of different times. That actually gave Jesus the opportunity to answer to the charges. "Are you the king of the Jews?" And Jesus said, "That's what you say." And then he goes back later and he says, "You know, there's a tradition that on Passover that you give over one of the people who is set to be executed and you give them a pardon, forgiveness." And so Pilate tried again. Maybe that will happen. So he lifted him up. Jesus, who was accused of claiming to be God, equal to Caesar at least, and Barabbas, who was one of the people who had been caught in an overthrow of the government, who had committed murder, and he himself was up for execution as well. So Pilate throws them out there and says, "Which one? Jesus, Barabbas?" The crowd chose Barabbas. "Are you sure?" "Yes." The crowd said, "Barabbas." "What do you want me to do with him?" they said. Or he said, "Kill him." They didn't say kill him because that hurts our sensitivities. But you know what crucify means, right? "Crucify him," they said. "Crucify him." So Pilate turns him over. He turns him over to the soldiers. The soldiers torture him. And they take him away into the governor's palace. And the whole company of soldiers, they taunt him. They put this crown that's made of twisted up thorns. And they press it down on his head so that his blood starts to pour down. They make fun of him. And it's not just one person that's making fun of him. It's everybody that's making fun of him. The soldiers are making fun of him. The chief priests and the elders and the legal scholars, they're making fun of him. The whole Sanhedrin, they're probably making fun of him. Mark's gospel even says that the people who were crucified on either side of Jesus, they were making fun of him. They press the crown down on his head. They put the title above his head, the King of the Jews. And then they mocked him and said, "Bring yourself down. You who said that you could destroy the temple and raise it again in 3 days, take yourself down off that cross if you're so big and bad." And they mocked him, even putting up sour wine to his lips. Come on. Over and over, this was what happened. And there are many different people all through the account. I named some of them. Legal experts, the scholars, the chief priests, the Sanhedrin, the soldiers, bands of soldiers. Mark's gospel also names these unnamed soldiers, an unnamed centurion who would watch Jesus die. Remember, he might, in Mark's gospel, maybe you don't know, but he's the one who, when he sees the way Jesus dies, he says this, "Surely this was God's son." And then there are these women who had been following Jesus the whole time. Some of them named, some of them not named. There's Mary Magdalene, there was Mary, you know, Joseph and James's mom. There was Salome. These women who had followed Jesus all along the road, they watched from a distance as Jesus was being crucified. They even saw, two of them saw where Jesus was being buried. So here's why Simon's name sticks out to me, I guess. There's a lot of different names that are lifted up in Mark's gospel. Soldiers, legal experts, some named like Pilate and Barabbas, and some unnamed like the crowds. But you know who keeps coming up missing in my mind? The ones who should have been there carrying his cross instead of Simon. And Simon, I'm not throwing shade at Simon. I think he was a great man, and he actually becomes a minor hero in the story of Jesus' crucifixion because he was compelled to take up the cross of Jesus and carry it to the crucifixion site. And so he's become a minor hero in the story of Jesus' crucifixion. In fact, that his name was listed as the father of Alexander and Rufus is probably a hint to later in the New Testament, when Rufus's name is lifted up, that's probably the same Rufus. This is probably his dad. This is probably the event, the earth-shaking, earth-shattering event in Simon's life, carrying the cross of Jesus. This could have very well been the thing that brought him to faith in this one that he saw crucified. The weapon of destruction who he was carrying for, it could have been the thing that turned him to allegiance to the Lord. We don't know that for sure. What we do know, his name is mentioned. But you know who I'm missing in the story? Reverend Johnson brought it up yesterday. You know who I'm missing in the story? That band of 12 that should have been right there, ready to pick up that cross and carry it for him. That band of 12 that he was right there just not 24 hours earlier, who he had been in the garden praying with. They were right there when he was arrested, and none of them are here to be seen. Now, again, Reverend Johnson kind of pointed us to this yesterday's sermon, but I want to remind you of this again. We have to go all the way back to chapter 14 in Mark's gospel to hear where these disciples are. Now, we don't know exactly where they are, but here's where they are. Mark's gospel says, "And all his disciples left him and ran away." It even goes so far as to name this other person. That some people think that this is Mark inserting himself into the gospel. It says, "There was one young man, a disciple," verse 51, "was wearing nothing but a linen cloth. They grabbed him, but he left the linen cloth behind and ran away naked." So desirous was he to get away from the scene that he left his clothes behind. It kind of gives us an indication of what's going on here. In verse 50 of chapter 14, it tells us where Jesus' disciples were when all this was happening to him. Now, like I said, it doesn't tell us specifically where they were. John's gospel kind of hints at where they were, because it says that they left here and they went into the upper room and they locked the door. Goodness. After Jesus' resurrection, he had to break in through a locked door to get to his disciples because they were so afraid that they were going to be killed that they ran for their lives. And so here, as Jesus is walking toward his death, toward his crucifixion, toward his execution, the leaders, they have to pull in this bystander, somebody walking through the city. He was coming in from the countryside, the scriptures say. And so they had to pull in this person, Simon of Cyrene, and make him carry the cross of Jesus. Why? Because none of his people were there. We had left him. Yeah, I said we. We had left him. And there are a lot of people who are complicit in the crucifixion of Jesus. The ones who cried for it. The ones who conspired for it. Like Judas, the ones who took money to set up the arrest. There were the ones who were standing by and jeering at Jesus and cheering on his crucifixion. There were the ones who were watching in this morbid curiosity as this person was hung there to die. There were the ones who were just kind of enthralled and getting a little bit of a high over watching this person being put down by the government. So yeah, we got those. Those are easy. That's low hanging fruit. But there's more than them that are complicit in the death of Jesus. They may have been the ones that nailed him to the cross and hung him there. They may have been the ones that made fun of him and put the crown of thorns on him, but they weren't the ones that abandoned him. We were. And in fact, I know that this is Good Friday. We're supposed to hang in on Good Friday. I'm the one that tells people to hang in there and don't get to Easter just yet. But I want to go there just for a second, because I want to remind you, on Easter, when Jesus finally does catch up to his disciples after he's been raised from the dead. Now, this is one of the distinctions between me and God. Now, there's a lot of those. There's a lot of distinctions between me and God. But here's one of them. If I'd been the one who had been raised from the dead, and then I go and find my 12 disciples who had been my closest companions for the last 3 years, and I find them in a locked room, do you know what my first words would have been? Where were you? Where did you go? What happened to you? Did you see what happened? But instead, do you know what Jesus' first words to his disciples are? I'll let you think about it for a minute. Peace. Peace be with you. Were his first words that he said to his disciples after his resurrection. Now that's not the first word that he said to Mary Magdalene in John's gospel. She mistakes him for the gardener, and then his first word to her was Mary. But he only said Mary after she said, Sir, can you tell me where they've taken my Lord? And then he reaches out and he says with compassion, speaks her name Mary, and then she gets it. Teacher, she says Rabboni, my teacher, you are mine. And she finally gets it. She grasps it. The first word out of Jesus' mouth after his resurrection to his disciples, the ones who had left the scene, who had fled and run for cover, is not, where were you? But peace be with you. Now, this week we have been living in these contradictions and these paradoxes of the gospel. And how crazy it is to think that, remember Wednesday, Sarah Scott, she showed us how crazy it was that Jesus said, the very one that I break the bread and hand it to, that's the one that's going to betray me. You remember that? The one that he broke the bread and handed it to, sitting in a place of honor, was Judas. And yet, you know what he didn't do? Withhold the bread from him. We heard even yesterday, Daniel was talking about the Lord's Supper. He said, for whom did Jesus die? Did Jesus die for some? Did Jesus die for the enfranchised, for the rich, for the entitled? No, Jesus died for all of us. And that meal has been prepared for each and every one of us. And here, we live in that same sort of contradiction where we have this crazy band of characters, most of whom are villains, leading up to the crucifixion of Jesus, and all of his allies, save this band of faithful women, have run for cover and run for the hills, and yet still Jesus dies. He didn't die for the ones who crucified him, well, not just for them. He didn't die for the ones that mocked him, not just for them. He didn't die for the ones who put the crown of thorns on his head, or who whipped him, who stripped him, and who laid him there to die. No. Not just for them, he also died for those of us who knew better and who walked away, who pretend that it doesn't happen, who pretend that it doesn't real, who try to make sense of it not making sense, and who try to pretend that this is not even a reality. Jesus died for us too, for his disciples. The ones that when he was arrested, I want you to go back and look at this. You can look in probably Luke chapter 23 or so, maybe Matthew chapter 27 or so, 26, John chapter 14, 15, Mark chapter 14. Look, and if you can find where Jesus told his disciples, if they come and arrest me, y'all run for cover. You find it. Show me. I want to hear that. He never said it. Instead, he said, you're going to suffer too. You're going to die right alongside of me. And yet when it came down to brass tacks, when it was time for everybody to make their decision, when the soldiers had come and taken him away, taken our Lord away, our best reaction was to run in fear. So here's the good news that I've got for you today. Jesus died. It's Good Friday. The good part in it is that Jesus died for the ones who convicted him, for the ones who assaulted him, for the ones who crucified him, for the ones that berated him, for the ones that put the crown of thorns on him, the ones that jeered him, the ones that sneered at him, the ones that stripped him, the ones that beat him, and the ones that buried him. And Jesus also died for the ones that ran from him, who denied him, who were scared to death, who watched at a safe distance. For those who deny that it's real, for those who hope that it's not, Jesus died for us, all of us. whether we're complicit directly in his death or we're complicit in some more subtle ways. The good news is the full extent of God's love was shown to us on Calvary's cross for all of us. So today, tomorrow, soak it in. It is a gift that has been given for you. Just for you, that you might live. And I say, thanks be to God. Now, as I close this afternoon, I want to leave you with a very quick thought in prayer. Some of y'all who are listening to this on the radio or watching this on YouTube or Facebook, you may not have any place to call your spiritual home. And some are intimidated to step into a church at any point, but especially on Easter, when it seems like crowds are bigger and things like that. But whether it's outside or in person, in a building or online, however it is, there are going to be churches gathering. All the ones that you heard this week, and there's scores more in this community who are going to be gathering up on Sunday over this weekend, and who I promise, I hope this is true, I promise that you can go to any of those churches and you're going to hear a word of hope. So if you need to hear a word of hope today and this weekend, and you're looking for a place to live out your faith journey, then look around. There's a lot of really good churches, a lot of great pastors, and a lot of great followers of Jesus with whom you can walk your journey of faith. You will find a message of hope. And I tell you, we need it. I need it. We all need it. So let's pray. Gracious God, we do thank and praise you for who you are, for the ways that you draw us into your presence, into your community. Lord, I thank you that Simon took up the cross and carried it when we had abandoned and run for the hills. Lord, I thank you that he told his sons about you, and that they may have been leaders in the early church movement. And Lord, I thank you that those disciples who were so scared for their own lives eventually would give those up as they proclaimed your name. We are grateful, God, for your death, for the sacrifice that you make for us, for the love that you pour out for us that extends even to death on a cross. We pray that we wouldn't take it for granted, but that we would instead see this as an avenue, a pathway, for us to experience new life in you. And we are grateful. And send us forth, we pray, to proclaim your name in everything that we do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Rock of it.